Timer is one of the important tools in speedcubing. After all, the point of speedcubing is to time one's soft and attempt to get faster and faster. However, speedcubing timers are expensive. A speedstack timer generation 4 costs around $35. To put it into perspective of how expensive it is, at least for me, that amount of money can buy me at least 14 lunches. Due to this, it is more common to see people triggering their timer in other manners, such as spacebar or touchscreen. But these aren't exactly good, since you need to use an actual timer during competition. So I designed and built SparkMouse timer, a Digispark based mouse speedcubing timer, which costed me around $1.50. You might be wondering, what is a mouse timer? That might seem weird at first, because who would have associated mouse and timer together anyway? Basically, mouse timer is a device resemblance of a typical speedcubing timer, but instead of timing, it sends mouse click to a device when pressed. From an electronic point of view, if you have disassembled a mouse before, you will see that the clicks buttons are nothing but a switch closing two terminals. If we connect that two terminals to two switches in series, where each switches are pressed by each hand, we essentially created a mouse timer. At this point, you probably realize that this is not a standalone instrument, but have to be connected to a host that can receive mouse click, such as a computer or your phone. I don't know how many of you know this, but the famous software timer, CS Timer, have support for mouse timer. You need to go into setting, timer, and check the use mouse timer checkbox. Now, when you click anywhere in the timer screen, it will be triggered. Looking into the Git report of the CS timer, we can see that the feature is added in 2016. But no, this concept of mouse timer have existed for far longer time. Before this, there is a timer by Omega Studio, which still exists today, and the first video about it on YouTube is from 2006, and is by the creator of the timer. In the description, he wrote, "I made the timer from a USB mouse, and wrote a program to simulate the tournament display." But anyway, the point is that this concept of mouse timer is old. The SparkMouse timer is far from being the first mouse timer that I have ever built. In fact, this is the fourth version that I have built. The first version is made out of toilet roll and aluminium foil. Yes, not even switches, since they are substituted with two pieces of aluminium foil. When I show this to my friend, he is like, "What are you doing?" "Oh, I made this timer that sends mouse click." "A timer made out of toilet roll?" "Yeah, I use it for every project. What's wrong with that?" "Are you kidding me? You use toilet roll everywhere? Let me show you how to build a proper timer." Then he proceeded and designed another one utilizing microswitches salvaged from old cache project, which are put under cardboard pads. I copied his design and called it my V2. Then I thought, why not make it smaller and V3 is born? Which is what I used until I designed the SparkMouse timer. Enough background, let's talk about how I designed this while having this time lapse in the background. I chose Digispark as the brand of the project because I don't feel like wasting pins. It can be programmed to work as a mouse, unlike Uno or Nano, and it is cheap. The body of my design is meant to be as simple as possible to make life easier when cutting the materials. No, this is definitely not because I'm not creative. Or am I? The material used in this project is mounting board, since it is the hardest material that I can process, well, with my razor cutter. I'm also making the whole thing as small as possible so that it is convenient to bring it everywhere. I decided to design the whole thing in computer-aided design program, because why not? Also, this is the second time I use CAD program, so you professional CAD user, don't laugh at me for doing stupid things, okay? I use FreeCAD since it is free and open source and doesn't need to pay for license. The capacitive sensors will be made out of two small pieces of aluminium foil, and the shape is going to be round, as I read somewhere that it is best to avoid sharp edges in capacitive sensor. But maybe it is not that important in this application. I will link the source in the description if I find it. Just FYI, I also have a written instruction on instruct tables if you find it hard to follow in the video, link in description. But anyway, to start off building this, the first step is to cut the materials. There is some hole that you need to drill as well. I also prepared a cutout that you can download at the instruct table and print it out. Just follow the drawing and you'll be fine. Next, we can start gluing the layers together. I use white glue and clear glue here, just don't use something like hot glue. It is a terrible idea to use that for this application. I will break the layers into two parts, bottom and middle layers. We will build the bottom and middle layers first. Counting from the bottom, layer 1 to 3 is glued together as bottom layers, and layer 4 to 5 as middle layers. After letting them dry, I drill holes at the appropriate place on the middle layers. Then we can start laying down wires on the bottom layers according to the schematic. The schematic can be found again in the instruct table. This step is to figure out the approximate length of wires needed for each piece of wire. With that being done, we can move on to soldering the wires and resistor together. Make sure to thin all the wires beforehand. I also solder a spliced USB cable directly to the USB contact. But you may improvise and solder a female micro USB or even a Type-C instead. After that, you may glue the board and wires permanently to the bottom layers. Now it is gluing time again, but this time it is a little trickier since I have to pass the wires through the drill hole. I start by applying glue on the bottom layers. Then I pass the wires through the holes drilled on the middle layers. Both layers are pressed together and let dry. To make the sensor, I cut two round pieces of aluminium foil that fit on the timer. Then I tap the exposed wire to the aluminium foil, lay it down on the timer and fix it on the middle layers with a small piece of tape. Then I just repeat for another side. Finally, I apply glue directly on top of the sensor and close it off with the final top layer. The middle compartment is also closed by gluing the top layer. At this stage, I realized that my mounting board is actually 1mm thick. But since I designed this with 1.5mm thickness, the Digispark doesn't quite fit unless I add an additional layer. Not really my fault, as the bookstore apparently sold me a thinner version of mounting board. Then I fill the hole at front with hot glue and cover it with a piece of scrap mounting board. And the build is complete. Programming time! The code logic is so simple that even 3-year-olds can understand how it works, so I will just briefly go over it. The program is initialized with previous state of not pressed, then it goes into a loop where it checks if both sensors exceed threshold. If true and previous state is not pressed, left click is engaged and previous state is set to pressed. If false and previous state is pressed, left click is disengaged and previous state is set to not pressed. First, I have to set up the Arduino IDE. I won't go into detail on how to do that. You can find setup guide at Digispark website or in the instruct table. Before uploading the main code, I first uploaded the calibration code to determine the value returned when the sensor is touched. This can be done by uploading the SparkMouse timer calibrate sketch and opening a text editor. After a while, it will type out the value in the text editor. Then, I touch the sensor and monitor how the values change and decide on a threshold. Next, I updated the threshold in the main code to appropriate value and finally upload the main code. And that marks the end of this project. The SparkMouse timer has a flaw. It doesn't work with all devices. This is due to the way Digispark works and emulates itself as a USB device. I'm lucky that it works with my laptop and phone. But upon testing with other devices I have access to, it seems that newer devices tend to have problems with it. The solution is to not use Digispark for this and replace it with something like ProMicro, but that will be a little more pricey. It took over a year of planning to get this simple project done. Overall, I'm really happy with how this project turns out. The way the capacitive sensors works as intended really does feel like magic sometimes. I hope that this project will be able to help anyone who cannot afford a timer or just like to make stuff from scratch. And I hope you learned something from this video. Also, make sure to check out the parody advertisement of SparkMouse timer that I released a while ago if you haven't. And thanks for watching.